Hey guys, this section is going to cover polling and public opinion. It is going to correspond to pages 195 to 200 in your textbook. As we go through this presentation, keep in mind our two focus questions. How do we measure public opinion? And how much do we trust that measurement? The first definition you need is public opinion. This is the distribution of the population's belief about politics and policy issues. Essentially, how do people feel about
how's the president doing? Who should be our next president?
What qualities do I look for in a president?
What issues do I even care about?
These questions and others like it are big questions, and you can't possibly poll every American. Instead, polls take a sample, a small proportion of people who are chosen to represent the whole. Whether that's looking at the opinion of all Americans or just certain demographics or voters, a sample makes it realistic. In order to make certain these samples are accurate, pollsters engage in random sampling, where everyone in the larger group has an equal probability of being selected. If you are polling average Americans, every American should have an equal chance of being chosen. Because you are not polling everyone, there is going to be some sampling error. The sampling error, or often called the margin of error, is the level of confidence in the findings of the poll. The larger the sample, the smaller the sampling error, although there are other factors. A small sampling error is good, as it indicates that you have a high level of confidence in your findings. The strongest polls typically poll between 1,000 and 1,500 people. Compared to the total population of the United States, that may seem small, but it's enough to allow pollsters to get an accurate feel and puts our margin of error at 2.4 to 3.4%, well within the acceptable range. Let's break down exactly what that means, although we're going to have to get a little mathematical. Don't worry, we'll get through it together, and you can ask questions at the end. If the most realistic and still acceptable sampling error is plus or minus 3%, that means that if you took the same poll over and over again, 95% of the time, the results will be within 3% of what the population actually thinks. So if I'm taking a poll about building the wall with Canada, and 60% of likely voters disapprove of that wall with our standard margin of error at plus or minus 3%, we can pretty safely say that 57 to 63% of the voters do not want you to build that wall. If I ask people about building a wall with Canada over and over again, including actually putting the question on the ballot, I would be consistently in that range and probably should not start calling construction companies. Keeping in mind sampling error, you are going to have to avoid bad polls. So we learned number one, looking at the sampling size and the sampling error. Number two is accurate representation. Is the method of collecting the data truly gathering a representative sample, or is it weighted towards certain demographic characteristics? The traditional and still prevalent way that pollsters do that is through random digit dialing. Random digit dialing is letting a computer randomly generate a list of phone numbers in the geographic area of your target sample. There are two modern problems with this. The first is the use of cell phones. 91% of Americans have a cell phone, and for 35% of households, it's their only phone. When you use a cell phone, you might not be on that randomly generated list because area codes are no longer consistent. The other drawback is the use of caller ID to avoid telemarketers and other unwanted calls. And some demographic groups are less likely to pick up their phone or cell phone than others. Random email is another technique. Again, it relies heavily on voluntary responses. Area probability sampling is choosing a few representative areas and then just randomly knocking on doors and hoping someone answers you. With these new challenges, be on the particular lookout for undersampling and oversampling. People who are older or wealthier are more likely to have a landline and answer the phone wanting to talk. Young people and minorities are less likely to answer the door or the phone. How does the poll compensate for these demographic trends? Oversampling of a traditionally underrepresented group is often encouraged to adjust for these challenges. This should be in the polling methodology, as will the way the poll was disseminated. So if you're asking a poll question on the internet, especially if you're putting the question out through Google Forms, Twitter, a particular website that targets a specific group, you are now going to have an overrepresentation of mostly young people. Worse, it is going to be self-selected. People who feel strongly will respond in large numbers, while those who are neutral or ill-informed won't be represented at all. Think of the comment section in a quantifiable form. Eek. Even if the poll is distributed evenly, they can still engender stronger or skewed feelings with the way they ask the question. These two polls were taken in 2010 and illustrate the way wording can really affect the way people respond. Both of these are assessing the favorability of the LGBTQ service in the military. The first poll, however, uses language that some older generations connote with subversive behavior, and it implies that the service member's sexual orientation would be a constant topic of conversation. The second question is much more passive, uses language that is more acceptable in the mainstream, and does not imply a disruption. The results demonstrate the 26% gap in favorability, largely based on the wording. Even when the poll data has a relatively neutral title, such as favorability of military service for LGBTQ citizens, check the methodology for the actual wording of the question. Are they using a neutral approach? Are they giving people an I don't know option or forcing a response regardless of their background information? Now let's use those criteria to practice evaluating some actual polls. This is Real Clear Politics. It's one of our two polling aggregate sites. The other is 538. Now, because I'm filming this in the middle of the summer and the election polls are crazy volatile, I'm going to look at President Obama's job approval rating instead. We'll look more at presidential approval ratings later in the year, so this will come in handy in two ways. On Real Clear Politics, we're going to ignore this highlighted yellow number at the top. This is their average of all the other polls, and it doesn't have a traditional methodology. They've just taken the other polls and they've averaged them. So we'll ignore this number for right now. Instead, we'll look at the polls below where there's an incredibly wide range of results. I want to draw your attention to two particular stark discrepancies. First is this Gallup result, which puts the president's approval rating at plus 10, 53% of people approve. And then there's this Reuters Ipsos poll right below it, which switches all the way to a minus 4, or a 45% approval rating. These two polls are the ones we're interested in because they have a 14% gap between their results over the same period of time. The last thing I want to draw your attention to on this page is the sample. This middle column gives you the number of people and the type of sample group, all Americans, likely voters, registered voters, for you to choose from. All right, so let's start with this Gallup poll. The title is vague, and this site is really distracting to me. There's some methodology information under the daily tracking chart. For example, we know that it's a binary choice between approve or disapprove, but you don't know the wording of the question. We also find this is a telephone poll. It doesn't explicitly say that it was done with random digit dialing, but I might cautiously infer it from a reassuring margin of error of plus or minus 3% and a good sample size of 1,500 respondents. But we are missing some serious methodology, and I want to continue to explore the website for more information before I completely trust this poll. The other poll was put out by Reuters and Ipsos, and it was collected a slightly more negative view of the president. What we want to do, again, is examine their methodology. This time, Real Clear Politics brings us to a pretty lengthy PDF. Right away, they tell you the sample size, which goes above and beyond our 1,000-person guideline. What I like about this is they've divided by political party as well as indicated the age. However, ooh, that is a big red flag for me. The polling interviews were conducted online. You have to be very careful with online polls because they tend to be a little more self-selecting than phone calls. Ipsos is a pioneer in the field and has built a reputation, but I would be cautious, especially because they don't have a traditional margin of error. We have to dig through the appendix to find what this credibility interval is and what all these numbers, which are all over the place, are useful for us. They do look at what needs to be weighted due to undersampling, but the lack of margin of error is troubling. What is very clear is the questioning methodology. That's something we didn't see from Gallup. They give you a specific question, although it does rely on people's preconception of handling his job and may indicate a slightly negative bias, it still does tell you what they were asking. The best part to me is the number of choices they actually give, even though they end up boiling it down to a binary approve or disapprove when it gets transferred to other media outlets.
In the end, you want to weigh all the criteria to determine the reliability of any given poll. In class, we're going to practice with some of the most recent election polls. So be prepared to come in, do some evaluating, and discuss the pros and cons of polls in our American democracy. So don't forget to check the links below, take the quiz, and ask any questions you might have before then. See you soon!